Shalom. Greetings to all and all. Now, let's see. This is Ross Alonso Tafari reporting for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society of His Imperial Majesty, the First Power of the Trinity, that's to say Haile Selassie I, and His Christ, Jesus, that's to say HaMashiach Yeshua. Now, we open up this presentation by giving thanks to Ainai Elder Brethren Razia Dinos Teferi for putting out, you know, the complete, you know, version up until this point in time revealed to us in and through Christ of Rastafari. That's to say, you know, we give thanks to Razia Dinos Teferi for being the one, at least in my personal experience and in that of many others, I'm sure, the one to really connect the dots and really bring the Holy Scriptures in unison, in tewahido, you know, to come together, come in unity with you know, the revelation of Rastafari and how it fits into place and how everything comes together. And, you know, just the you know, all the motivation that came from and continues to come from Ainai Elder, I just know it's necessary to, you know, accredit those to whom deserve such credit, so we give thanks. And with that, we open this presentation mentioning that it's 6:44 p.m. Today is Wednesday, January 10th, 2018, and we shall proceed in bringing forth a summary of an already viewed presentation, viewed on our behalf, uploaded to YouTube. And so the topic is of great significance and very important, thus we will reference the video we are talking about, but we ourselves will present, you know, kind of like a rough summary of what we were able to put down on our notebooks and stuff like that regarding the presentation. Now, let's see, maybe a good beginning would be in the name of the Most High God, you know, Jah Rastafari, and pray for a good ending, a blessed ending, all in His name. Now, this is kind of like, this is a video still of, I think it's David D. Daniels III, if I'm not mistaken. And so, basically, this is another, well, just vertical image of the same, which we just showed a second ago. So basically, I know it's kind of blurry. The camera is in focus. So it reads, Ethiopian Christianity in the World of Martin Luther and 16th Century Protestant Men. How is it? 16th century Protestantism, you know, that's the title of the video. One can find it on YouTube. We recommend it so that any areas that we leave unclear, you know, the presenter definitely will, you know, shed light to that. So interesting. 31 views, 1 like. The channel is Princeton Theological something. Now, this was published on December 20th, 2017. But it reads here that the presentation was given on November 1st, 2017. So this is very recent information and very new information, although it doesn't surprise us the very least. And all this is due to the 500th year anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. And so let's continue reforming the things that need be formed, you know, because in the beginning, you know, the, what does it read? In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, but then it goes on to read that the earth, find that real quick. The earth was without form and void. darkness was upon the face of the deep. Thus, let us, continue the reformation in the new and living way, which is to be the new man, So, let us continue, I guess. This is kind of weird, doing presentations in English. We haven't done very much of that in a long time. And we've decided from now on we're going to do whatever we put out in Spanish, we'll do in English, because the information that we have to share personally is very much necessary, and it's, although brethren and sisters are doing their part, some of us, receive, many things that many others may not have received, and so it's good to see different angles and perspectives on the same story, which sheds more and more light to the facts, the truth, the reality of the situation. Now, continuing. Luther. These are just random notes in our notebook, so we're going to do the best we can and just kind of like make this into something. But I remind everyone, it's a summary of that presentation video you can find on YouTube. It's titled Ethiopian Christianity in the World of Martin Luther and 16th Century Protestantism. And the presentation is by Dr. David D. Daniels. Now, let us begin. David D. Daniels has a slideshow, or, has some notes on a screen, and this is the title that reads in the beginning: Martin Luther, Michael the Deacon, and Ethiopian Christianity. So just random statements quoted from Luther is that Ethiopia is the first to turn to Christ, that Ethiopia serves as an older, wiser sibling, black sibling to more younger European churches. And later on he continues to say that a older, wiser black brother empire to more younger European empires. Continuing with these random statements that appeared projected on some kind of screen during the presentation in the video, continues to read that Dream Church Ethiopia is the Dream Church of Martin Luther and serves as a model to Protestantism. And another, I guess, note is that eventually Martin Luther met with the Ethiopian deacon Michael. Let's see. More than anything, Dr. David D. Daniels, excuse, I forgot to mention doctor earlier, he says that if anything can come from this is to just correct history and make an adjustment, if anything is possible, so that the outlook of the Protestant Reformation is not only accredited as being a purely white European thing, but that, Ethiopians in particular, but blacks blacks to generalize, had much to do with the Protestant Reformation. So it's not only a Western civilization, white European thing. And this is, like Dr. David D. Daniels mentioned, a humble, goal. Now, the notes on his screen, whatever it is, mentions that during the 1500s there was an increase in interest in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. He mentions individuals that showed interest in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, such as Erasmus of Rotterdam, Thomas More, Pope Clement the VII. Now, he goes on to mention that within the 55 volumes of Lutheran's work, which have been translated into English, certain letters of importance are not translated. That is to say, they're missing from the English translation of the works of Luther in his 55 volumes. And contrary to the versions in Latin and German, these important letters mentioned by Dr. David D. Daniels are very well present. And coincidentally enough, maybe not, those letters are in direct relation to the meeting of the deacon, Ethiopian deacon Michael, and Martin Luther, and one of his associates, or Luther, who eventually would become known as an important Lutheran scholar. Now, within these 55 volumes of Lutheran's work, in the English does not appear the important letters in regards to the Ethiopian deacon Michael. Even that being the case, there are 85 separate mentions of Ethiopia in relations to place, Bible passages, issues, stuff of that nature. Aside from these 85 scattered, let me emphasize scattered mentions of Ethiopia, there are an additional 15 mentions of contemporary Christian Ethiopian Empire. That is to say, contemporary, mentions of Ethiopia in its contemporary form. And let me emphasize once more that all this scattered. That's to say that, you know, like one mention here, Ethiopia, another mention there. There's a total of 85 and then an additional 15. In the English, they still owe us the translation of the information in regards to Michael, the deacon, Ethiopian deacon. Now, what I'm about to say actually kind of like, it fits in perfectly with the reason why I and I chose to emphasize the word scattered. But before, I think it's a good time to mention that Dr. David D. Daniels, he takes time to express the fact that he's taken on the liberty of making a story out of all these scattered mentionings of Ethiopia, as to suggest that quite possibly a narrative can come from all this scattered information and form a single body. Although he doesn't say a single body or nothing like that, we can add to his statement to form an organism, you know, a body, with shape and details and a purpose. Now, it's very important to, you know, pick up on what he's doing. In other words, up until this Dr. David D. Daniels, no one has shared or demonstrated any interest in accumulating all those mentions of Ethiopia, like in Martin Luther's part, and kind of like figure out what's the story behind this. So up until this, you know, just recently, we would have just found scattered remnants of knowledge. Now, it's interesting because not only are we scattered to all corners of this earth, but the knowledge also is scattered to all corners of this earth. And specifically, like in the context of this presentation, within the 55 volumes of Martin Luther's work, we find 85 plus 15 mentions of Ethiopia in a scattered, dispersed form. Now, what is it about this? What is the purpose? And to add to this, why was the important letters in regards to the meeting of Martin Luther and the Ethiopian deacon Michael, why were they not translated into English? Well, it's because, our personal point of view is because it's whether subtly or subconsciously or purposefully, it is the continuation or the continuing promotion of the false claim of white supremacy, per se. Now, how do we conclude this? Well, because we are very well trained as people, programmed, black or white, to not put things together when it comes to things of very significant, or things very significant or of very high importance. For instance, when it comes to Ethiopia, black or white, don't matter, we all do a horrible job in the sense that we are successful in something that we should not be successful at, and that is to downplay anything in relations to Ethiopia, in the sense that we separate all the known facts, knowledge, and truths, realities that are just universally accepted in relations to Ethiopia. Even information, we are speaking about information that is just absolutely indisputable, that everybody agrees on. We're not even going into, like, you know, some of the theological issues, like, you know, like arguments and stuff like that that we as Rastafari bring forth. Let's keep it simple. We're talking about just stuff that is bluntly or plainly known and accepted. We don't regard any of that many information, because it's scattered, we don't regard it as significant, because it forms part of nothing. It has no purpose, it has no shape, no image, no likeness. Everything is scattered and dispersed, and we refuse to contemplate the possibility that perhaps that information can be accumulated, brought together, gathered, and something can come from it. We automatically dismiss it as, for example, Ethiopia, we know that is the first, you know, nation to receive Christ, to convert to Christianity. So we say, oh, big deal, that means nothing. What about the fact that there's black Jews in Ethiopia since before Christianity? Oh, well, you know, big coincidence, so what? Oh, you know, the story of Solomon and Sheba in Ethiopia. Oh, yeah, so what? Okay, you know, just a whole bunch of the first illuminated and oldest version of, you know, original handwritten version of the Gospels. The oldest, you know, copy, even illustrated, is found in Ethiopia, and dated the earliest, you know, intact in its original state. So, and it's found in the monastery of Garima, the monastery of Garima, and so we say, oh, big deal, we don't promote it, we don't emphasize its importance, its value, we diminish its value. Why? Because we've been trained to, you know, to continue in a scattered form and not connect the dots or put things together, because then things become very, very obvious, and the obvious of truth becomes, in this case, because it's in relation to Christ and His Imperial Majesty, then it becomes our liberation, our freedom, and something desires the prevention of that. What it is, who cares? Now, this is in part why I believe that the English does not include the information in regards to Michael, the Ethiopian deacon, because of the world that was falsely being attempted to be presented as truth or reality, when in fact it was just a false attempt to, you know, to paint a picture that wasn't necessarily accurate, to promote this false agenda, this lie of a superiority amongst whites. That's to say, avoid any clarity as far as the significance of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church in white business, white European business. You know, if the individual has to, for his own conscious sake, testify to truth that he holds within, keep it to a bare minimum, to where it's not very clear or obvious that without the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, Martin Luther couldn't have possibly initiated what is accredited to him as the Protestant Reformation. He never states that. He just makes brief mention, scattered remnants of truth, you know, with the intent, I believe, whether purposely or subconsciously, to avoid disrupting the false image that at that time is beginning to, there's an attempt to portray the world a certain way, and it's not the case. The fact that Ethiopia is so important to the Protestant Reformation completely obliterates the false image that has been painted in regards to the reality, the truth of what was going on in the 1500 in relations to the lie that has been perpetrated. That's to say white supremacy and the inferiority of black people, first and foremost, and along with that, indigenous peoples and wherever their habitats may have been. So, or basically the superiority of one person over another. Now, this falsehood, we begin to learn that was not necessarily or completely the case, but it was attempted to, now it has been, the cover-up has attempted to make it seem as if that's the case. I don't know when it began, probably since before even the atrocities began, but who cares? The point is that, you know, there's this attempt to downplay or make less the significance of, obviously, black people in major contributions to the world, being that the attempt at that time and even to this day is to make black people inferior and to continue on with the slave trade. So now, the cross-Ethiopic Ocean slave trade, formerly known as the transatlantic slave trade, and the so-called discovery age. Now, in other words, what are we trying to say? That how is it going to sound if one of the most, you know, one of the biggest revolutions, the Protestant Reformation that's taking place, how is it going to look if it's accredited, its origin is inspired, motivated, and accredited to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, which is a representative of not only black people, but Africa as a whole. How is that going to look when you're transporting Africans that have been stolen and enslaved off, you know, and sailed across the seas to eventually be purchased, and put to hard labor, you know, to death, in other words. How is that going to sound? So I'm pretty sure Martin Luther was, you know, capable of acknowledging this conflict within his own experience. And somehow it's been, he wisely, for his own sake probably, you know, did not make things so obvious. But to me, it's obvious that without the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, Martin Luther can do nothing. And we'll explain a little bit as to why we make that claim, that seemingly, from a superficial point of view, seemingly bold claim, but rather just sincere and honest. And which is why the important letters that document the meeting between the Ethiopian deacon Michael and Martin Luther are not translated into English, but can be found in the versions in German and Latin. Now, continuing. Oh, and another thing is because Martin Luther makes some very bold claims, being a white person in white Europe, in a white so-called world where white supremacy is the so-called, you know, reality. Martin Luther basically gets down on his knees and, you know, like, submits himself to the reality, and in relations to, you know, God's purpose and his relation to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. And so to say the things that Martin Luther says is bad enough for a world that's trying to promote the lie of white supremacy. So, you know, that's the reason why we kind of like went into some some elaboration in regards to the scattered remnants of knowledge and truth. Continuing on, you know, the presenter makes mention that evidence to support the fact that there's an increase in interest in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church during the 15th century is that there's the printing of the Ethiopic Psalter in Europe, first in Rome in 1513, and also the printing of the Ethiopian New Testament, first in Rome in 1545 to 49, and later both the Ethiopic Psalter and the New Testament, later printed in Germany. So all this during the 15th century. Francisco Alvarez, the Portuguese, is also mentioned. In other words, let me just make mention that Martin Luther begins to develop from his studies an idea, an expectation, a hope, an image, an imagination, we could say at this point, just kind of like a rough draft, an assumption of what the Ethiopian Orthodox Church sounds like to be. And all this from, you know, knowledge obtained through studies, personally, through Martin Luther. So his hope is elevated in that he sees something that now he needs to confirm if it really exists, and this is very crucial because then it would validate his, that feeling that he has inside of him to go on with this fight, which is, you know, later to be termed the Protestant Reformation. But he needs, you know, if the Catholic Roman Church was center of authority at that time and you're going to break off from it, it's a spiritual fight within itself, because, you know, the Roman Catholic Church claims to be, you know, representatives of God, blah blah blah, and so you're breaking away from God in a way. So you really need to be like certain that what you're doing is true. You need backup, you need evidence, you need support, you need a foundation to build on in regards to even the conscience of the self, to live with a clear conscience in that what you're doing is correct, and it is, you know, it is going to triumph, and it has been done before, and there's nothing wrong to go against the Roman Catholic institution. You know, these are things that had to be established, you know, firmly within Martin Luther before he can continue on in this, you know, like, this work of his. So, through his studies, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, I say, became his inspiration, but now he had to really confirm it, affirm what he thought it to be based on his studies. And that is why it's so important that the Ethiopian deacon Michael travels to Germany in a time when blacks are said to only be transferred from captivity to slavery, you know, and death. So this completely, you know, shatters the false reality of what's going on in the 15th century. Now, continuing, let's see our notes here. These are out of the 85 scattered remnants, mentions of Ethiopia. And there's an additional 15. The presenter kind of points out in his notes 5. One reads, when mention is made of nations that are to be converted to Christ, Ethiopians are singled out for mention. This is nothing negative. In other words, Ethiopians are not included in those that are to turn to Christ, because Ethiopians have always had Christ since the beginning. So it makes it, you know, a special comment, statement. Next, it says, for the Ethiopians denote those who have the ardent faith. Next, it says, and these are all statements that Martin Luther has made in relations to Ethiopia. The people of the Ethiopians are said to be the church of the Gentiles. I agree with this. It's the nation which God chose to be his after divorcing Israel, per se, or putting her away, leaving Jerusalem, you know, transferring the power, authority from Jerusalem to Ethiopia, and establishing what would eventually be, you know, the acceptance of the national Christian, you know, the first national Christians, which is Ethiopia, Gentiles, nations, and not excluding, you know, the previous or former, like, mixed with Israel and, you know, all that. We'll make mention of that later on, because Ethiopia is unique in that not only is it the first nation to receive, to convert to Christ and profess Him as salvation or Savior, but it's also the first Hebrews or Jews, to put it in those terms, to accept Christ as Mashiach. So you have in Ethiopia the first, you know, of the first Jews to accept Mashiach in Yeshua, and the first nation to accept Christ. So you have, you know, you have both Jew and Greek, as the New Testament would put it, accepting one reality, one truth. So the notes go on to say, and those in Ethiopia denote the Church of Gentiles. Maybe I wrote this twice. Let's see. Continue, it says, but the church is symbolized and called by the name Ethiopia. And there's a note within the notes of the of Dr. David D. Daniels, and it read 1 Psalm and 3 reaffirmed in Lecture of Song of Solomon. Not sure what that led to, probably some more information that, you know, supports this claim. Now just to comment on these claims, these are 5 of the 85 mentions of Ethiopia in the 55 volumes of Martin Luther's works. So these are very, very bold claims of truth that go against the so-called status quo of the 1500s. And, well, just, you know, consider that for a moment. Now, continuing on, it says, more notes, you know, taken from the video. 1534, Luther converses with the deacon, Ethiopian deacon Michael. Let's see. The Ethiopian church held at a very high esteem by Martin Luther. Luther extends full communion to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Ethiopia is to Luther a model, his dream church. The meeting allows Luther to test his beliefs of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church and would confirm if that same Church of Ethiopia is actually possible, is a possible forerunner of Protestantism, and if it is in fact theologically equivalent. Now consider that it took 1500 years for you know many of us to reform from you know, to do that whole breaking off from Vatican Rome, although not completely, because, you know, what's in a man's heart will unite him with those that, you know, feel the same way. So even if there's no physical ties, which there is, even if that wouldn't be the case, still, a man will act according to his heart, you know. And so when people are evil, you know, like they're evil. For example, Protestants won't accept, many will not accept, you know, blacks to do anything with, to have to do, they will not accept certain things. So it doesn't matter if they so-called broke off, you know, wickedness is wickedness, and, you know, wickedness unites in their actions and, you know, what real reform. But granted, there was a recognition of a need to break off because of the superior corruption, perhaps, of the Catholic Roman Church, and, you know, the model church that was being looked at to you know, be the hope, the inspiration to this movement, in, you know, in that it would establish an already set, not principle, but it would lay a foundation to attempt something. Actually, this kind of, now that I'm thinking about it, it kind of makes Martin Luther, like, not so bold, because, you know, if someone really feels something in their heart and is committed to it, they go off and do whatever they got to do, you know, like, no fear. And if one is willing to pay the consequences of his mistake and, you know, receive the honor of the triumph, all honor to Jah, of course, but still, this kind of just points out the fact that Martin Luther wasn't capable of doing something without first having, you know, a confirmation that, okay, there's another church that don't give a about Pope authority. They are this, they are that. Okay, it's going to work out. It's a go. So anyways, that's, you know, my personal comment, my personal observation. Nonetheless, continuing. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church basically represented Africa, and the travels of the Ethiopian Deacon Michael to Europe to meet the Reformation leaders in the 1500s in Germany is kind of like, you know, completely against what we are taught in regards to that period in time in history, due to the transatlantic or trans-Ethiopic ocean slave trade and the doctrine of discovery in the Americas. Dr. David D. Daniels mentions that around that time, roughly there's 200,000 Africans, whether Ethiopians or of different, you know, backgrounds or environment. They're living around the Mediterranean Sea area in Europe. Let's see, Luther claims that Ethiopians are the first to turn to Christ. Luther claims that at least one, if not two, of the Magi are from Ethiopia. All three of them were from Ethiopia. If indeed it was only three of them, one was actual Negus, or king, emperor of Ethiopia. His name was Belteshazzar. It's kind of like, it's interesting, it's kind of like very similar to the Persian name given to Daniel. And the other two that I know exist were from Seba and Sheba. You can find that information in Psalm 72. And those from, you know, the kings from Seba and Sheba shall bring forth their presence. So all three of them were Ethiopian in the sense that Seba and Sheba were governed by the prime authority, Ethiopia. So they were, regardless if they were provinces or they're Ethiopian by, you know, by nationality. So in that sense, all of them were Ethiopians. And verse 9 of that same Psalm 72, although in the English and Hebrew it doesn't say it, it says, "They that dwell in the wilderness shall bow before him." Well, in the Spanish and in the Amharic, it says that the Ethiopians shall bow before him. So, you know, more evidence to support the fact that those that presented gifts to the young Jesus or Yeshua were in fact Ethiopian, as Martin Luther claims that one, if two, if not at least one of them, of the Magi, were from Ethiopia. Continuing, Martin Luther states that he accredits the Ethiopians with teaching the Samaritans after being converted by Philip. Luther claims that Matthew, the Apostle Matthew, and or Evangelist Matthew, and his companions introduced the gospel personally to Ethiopia, Arabia, Edom, and Egypt. There's information to support this. The Evangelist or Apostle Matthew actually was martyred in Ethiopia. Continuing, Martin Luther claims that Ethiopia represents the edge of the inhabited earth, the distant people from the farthest, you know, they shall come from the farthest regions of the world. Now, Martin Luther claims that the Desert Fathers sojourn in Ethiopia during the first century. This probably has to do with the monasticism or monastic life, which is big in Egypt and in Ethiopia, monks per se. And continuing, it reads, Martin Luther claims that he applauded the deserts or the wilderness. There's a hint of Ethiopia where no one has ever demonstrated greater zeal in coming to Jah, to God, as in the deserts of Egypt and Ethiopia. Martin Luther continues in claiming that the Ethiopians are those who have the heart and faith, and the most fervent, and are the most fervent in their faith to Christ, and are nearest to Christ, and Christ to them. This is what Martin Luther, you know, within those 85 plus 15 scattered mentions of Ethiopia, in the 55 volumes of Lutheran's works, he claims that the Ethiopians are the closest to Christ and Christ to them. You know, very clear. So now, Lutheran acknowledges black Jews in Ethiopia, linking Israel to Ethiopia. He mentions that the Jews to accept Christ for the first time and Gentiles to profess Christ as Savior are, you know, Ethiopian. Ethiopia serves as a big black Christian empire brother to more younger European nations. Ethiopia has a longevity that Europeans do not have. Martin Luther claims that the Psalm 87, although I believe this is a misquote, I believe it's most likely Psalm 69, princess shall come out of Egypt, Ethiopia shall stretch forth her hands to God. Well, Martin Luther claims that this is fulfilled in Ethiopia receiving Christ first. Ethiopia, according to Martin Luther, represents that Christ shall come to all peoples and represents all people, black, white, this or that. That Ethiopia is outside and thus not corrupted by Roman Catholic schism. He claims, Martin Luther claims that the Ethiopian Orthodox Church has apostolic practices no longer in Catholic service and later adopted by Protestantism, Reformation not only, basically, you know, to sum this all up, that the Reformation is not only a Western civilization, white, you know, European thing, but it is more universal than such. Martin Luther claims that, or he, when he refers to what we would call the Ethiopian eunuch, Martin Luther emphasizes or calls him by his office, treasurer or chamberlain, not reducing him to a mere eunuch. This is significant. Luther desires the reform to go in the direction of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. In it, Luther found a biblical reference and a historical reference, that is to say, narrative. Ethiopia is a symbol of Christianity, according to Martin Luther. Ethiopian Orthodox Church. First of all, Luther said that the Orthodoxy is acceptable because of Ethiopia, a part of it. And he says, among all the Orthodoxes in the world, Ethiopia ranks the highest. Continuing, he says that Ethiopian Orthodox Church has found honor, and Rome is put to shame, Rome is to be accredited to shame. So, I say that the Ethiopian Orthodox Church offered spiritual validity to break off from Rome, the Roman Catholic schism, and as a godly or good work that has been done, that Rome isn't in control, basically, that there's been, you know, power and authority that never has been under Rome, stuff like that. So it is possible, in other words. Let's see. And yeah, that concludes our summary of this video. We recommend that one swatch it. If you don't, at least you get an idea of what's being talked about. Let's see. The title for the video can be found on YouTube. It's called Ethiopian Christianity and the World of Martin Luther and 16th Century Protestantism. I'm still working on my English. Protestantism. So there we go. Presentation by Dr. David D. Daniels, commemorating the 500th year anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. And last note, I always thought it's interesting that the interview, Christmas in Ethiopia, done by Oswald Hoffman, you know, his interview with Haile Selassie I, Emperor of Ethiopia, in that Christmas special, I always thought that it's interesting because, you know, in that interview, His Majesty pretty much lays the foundation to what Rastafari is, you know, all the basics, and very clear and very just, you know, it's what it is, what we are is, you know, it's all pretty much summed in those questions and answers. And so, you know, I always, you know, to those that have any connection to the Lutheran World Federation or church, I've always mentioned, you know what, for whatever reason, God picked the Lutheran Church to be the vessel through which broadcasted to peoples all around the world would be that information that is so necessary to Rastafari in particular, because we as a people know all of other people's histories, but we don't know our history. We refuse the Bible, we refuse the reality of the situation, and desire to benefit from the claims that are supportless when we have no knowledge to sustain our claim. You know, unfortunately that has been, but at the same time it's to fulfill prophecy, because the first generation did not make it. They wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, and here we are now, you know, coming to the newly revealed information. And it's not to make less any of the elders. They did their part, you know, like man must be born from a woman, a child, a baby, a child, you know, a teen, an adult, and finally, job permit, an old man. In like manner, all things are to obey the laws of nature, and thus a movement, a revelation, also, a changing consciousness, even consciousness collectively itself has to develop in its infant stages as a baby, a child, you know, a teen, a young man, an adult, and finally an old man. So, you know, it's just a process of time is what it is. The elders did what they had to do. They didn't have, you know, at their fingertips, devices that could, you know, search the pages of history for, you know, for whatever purpose the individual puts value to. Now we do have those weapons of mass destruction to lies, deceit, and bullshit, basically. Let us use them wisely. The elders did not have that. You know, the elders didn't have all the advances in technology that permit us to, you know, I guess, learn all kinds of things. And so it's not to make the elders less, but as people, we need to pick it up and actually pick up the Bible and start to study. Yeah, and that interview, basically, it's very, very telling. Basically lays out all the important, everything's important in Rastafari, but the, you know, the principalities, the rudiments. Let's see if we can find, just, here we go. Oh, what's going on? Let's see. Well, you know, we tried.